Right, so this is Danny Flexen for Seconds Out. Delighted to be joined once again by Lou DiBella for the latest DiBella's Digest. And as you can tell in both our backgrounds, it's Christmas. Or almost, anyway.
Almost. Merry Christmas in advance, Danny.
How's your week been during this festive season?
Well, we got a big snowstorm yesterday, so it looks the part. It looks like a white Christmas here on Long Island. And I had Amanda Serrano fight last night in the Dominican Republic. And she knocked a woman out in the first round, looked sort of savage. I have Charles Conwell fighting tonight on NBC Sportsnet on that new Ring City series. Yep. Stephen Shaw, the undefeated American heavyweight, former U.S. national amateur champion, is fighting on the same card against the kid that Joe DiGuardia promotes named Pinchuk. And so I'm looking forward to seeing some of my fighters in action tonight and hopefully another positive couple of results like last night. Conwell's got a pretty tough fight in front of him against an undefeated Russian kid that main events Kathy Duva promotes, that Igis Klemis manages. But I think that I expect Conwell to pass the test and look pretty good.
Now, you mentioned Amanda Serrano. She got rid of Diana Santana a lot earlier than in their first meeting, so definitely an improvement upon that.
I mean, the first fight was 8.5 tough rounds. I mean, I was there, it was at the Barclays Center, and it was a tough fight. I mean, Amanda stopped her late, but it was give and take kind of fight. I think there was a lot of pent up training from multiple fights that didn't happen in 2020 with Amanda, and then she just went out there, and there was a barrage in the first minute and a half of the fight, and I mean, really a blitzkrieg, and it was pretty impressive. I mean, that's the element of Amanda's game that makes her different than so many of the women. Is she has real power. You know, I mean, she has over a 75% knockout ratio. And, you know, she's got significant power. And you saw it last night.
So what's the future for her? Obviously, we want the Katie Taylor fight. I know you've wanted the Katie Taylor fight a number of times in the past.
It'll happen. But I think right now that she's at 126 comfortably. I think that she'd like to unify in 2021. So, I mean, that would be two fights, one with Jelena from Canada, who's fighting tonight. Jelena's defending her WBA title, I think, not her BC title, but she's defending her WBA title tonight on that Ring City series. And the WBC, where Amanda's the interim champion, Jelena's the regular champion, they're ordering that the two meet within 90 days of after tonight's fight. So I'll be rooting for Jelena and then hoping to make that unification. And then Sarah Mahfood, who we originally intended on fighting in December in a unification. She's the IBF champion from Denmark, very good fighter. I think that would be the other fight that'd be targeted for 2021 to try to unify at featherweight. And I think as soon as that happens and she's unified, I think, you know, Michaela Mayer at 130 becomes more of a possibility. And the Katie fight, I still think, is the biggest and best fight you could make in women's boxing. But I think it deserves to be in a room with a crowd and, you know, appropriate training and neutral officials and all those good things that weren't going to happen had the fight happened in August. So, I mean, that's still a fight that I think everyone wants to see. And I think it's really interesting style matchup. You know, Katie Taylor's a great, great fighter and a great technician and like so fundamentally sound. I think that punching element, that power element that Amanda brings and her athleticism, I think it's a really, really, really good matchup.
Now, we've seen female boxing increase in prominence during 2020, and a lot of critics have said that's because there's not as much money to go around. There's not as much activity, and male fighters perhaps at a certain level aren't willing to take less money with the constrained circumstances.
Whereas, well, I think the difference is, first of all, women's title fights are way, way less expensive. So yeah. During the pandemic where money was a big, big issue, women got some additional opportunities. And look, anything that gives them opportunities are great. But a lot of the reason they were getting them is because they're so relatively inexpensive. But that doesn't change the fact it's a good thing for women, you know, particularly in the UK, where you saw a lot of activity for women. There was a lot less activity for women in the US. So, you know, I think that, you know, if a woman can headline a show and do big numbers, then, you know, I think that at some point there's got to be an adjustment up on what these, you know, what these ladies get paid. You know, but that being said, I think that people getting to see a lot of quality women fights over the last 6 or 8 months is only a good thing for women's boxing. I'm hoping for more opportunities, particularly in North America and particularly in the U.S. for women in 2021. 2020 was a really washout year in many ways here. I mean, look, obviously the U.S. has never gotten its stuff together during this pandemic, so we've been hit harder and closed down more than I think anybody else. And hopefully, you know, in 2021, we'll see more of the big fights. One interesting thing about women's boxing and why, another reason why I think there was quite a bit of it lately. I think in the pandemic, with decreased purses for fighters who had who were under contract, the male fighters traded off additional money to fight more keep busy kind of fights.
Sure.
Whereas women are so in need of opportunity and so desirous of activity and fighting that you really don't see women turning fights down. So, you know, it's much easier to get a woman in the ring in a 50-50 fight than it is her male counterpart. And, you know, women deserve some credit for that, the women in boxing. But it's absolutely true. I mean, you saw a lot of fights over the last 6 months, particularly that on paper were somewhat imbalanced. But, you know, when you look behind the business behind the fight, it was fighters fighting for their minimums or below. And I guess often the trade-off is, okay, I'll take less money, but I'm not willing to put myself at high risk for less money.
Now, eventually, crowds will come back. Boxing will return to some semblance of normality. What happens to female boxing then? Does the credit they've accrued over this period kind of translate, or does it go back to the status quo?
It'll be easier for women's boxing when crowds come back, because women are able to sell tickets. They are attractions, and that will bring more money into the pot. And right now they've been particularly harmed by the bubbles, particularly in the, you know, in the U.S. So the top 25 women in the U.S., I think only 5 of them fought this year. So I think that crowds will help. You know, what women need, particularly in North America, is television outlets giving them opportunities. And that's what hasn't been here. I mean, PBC doesn't feature women fighters. And so that's Fox, FS1, Showtime now, that really not featuring women. ESPN's clearly not in the business of doing female boxing, other than Michaela Mayer, who's signed with Top Rank and has been somewhat active. But it's not, ESPN's not a platform of opportunity for women in a general sense. Eddie's got obviously a nice stable of women. I mean, I think Eddie and myself probably have the most women in our promotional companies. And I think he's picked up activity for the women in the UK, but I think it's pretty much been centered on the UK.
Sure.
And on foreign fighters. So it's been a difficult stretch for American women, and hopefully 2021 will be better. I think that by mid 2021, we certainly should be back to some kind of crowds. And I think that will be a big plus. And I'm also hoping that with more exposure being given to women, that there will be new platforms that open up for women in the U.S. And I'm working on some stuff and behind the scenes trying to encourage opportunities for women to emerge. I'm optimistic that it will get better. But this pandemic has been a disproportionate hit to female boxers in North America.
What about Ring City, who we've just talked about? Do you get the impression from them that they're more open to featuring women on television on a regular basis?
Yeah, they're one of the platforms I've been talking to. I'm hoping to do a female card March, maybe, which is International Women's Month. So I pitched a female card to Ring City, you know, an all woman card. So I'm hopeful that we can get that off the, you know, off the ground. I think that March is a nice month for activity for female fighters to pick up again. We'll be starting to, the vaccine will be more widely distributed. We'll be coming out a little bit, hopefully starting to come out of the pandemic, even if we have to do it with a small, tiny crowd or no crowd. It should be a lot more manageable by then. And I think International Women's Month is a pretty good month to make a statement.
Is this a concept that's close to your heart, but or is it more a commercial proposition in that you see that there's an untapped?
You know, it started out as a commercial thing that I saw opportunity, and I thought there was a lot more talent. And I think the women fighters have interesting stories. A lot of them are, you know, I mean, almost all of them have other jobs or have had other jobs. A lot of them are single moms or, you know, have interesting backgrounds and lives. So the more time I spent working with the women in boxing, the more it became more of a cause and a little bit less commercial, probably partially because I haven't really made money doing it. It's very hard to, you know, to when you promote a lot of women, it's much more of a break-even proposition than it is a moneymaker at this moment in time. Hopefully that will change. I'm still optimistic that it may change. You know, so I guess in answer to your question, I would say it started off as a commercial thing and it's become a very personal one. It's become something of a cause for me. And I think that I think women deserve better than they've been getting. And I actually think it'd be good for boxing if women's boxing was appropriately scheduled on a regular basis, appropriately promoted with television and streaming opportunities, not commensurate necessarily with the men, but commensurate with the talent pool that exists. Because right now, female world champions in the United States, super quality prospects who are women, super quality boxers, are left with very few opportunities. And even for a promoter like myself, particularly when you're handcuffed because you can't sell tickets and run a normal show, the lack of television and streaming support for women is a big, big problem.
Now, we're going to try and squeeze one more of these digests in before the end of the year, before Christmas Eve, of course. We're going to give you the holidays off. We're good like that.
Good.
You might want to start thinking about your fights and fighters of the year. I think that's going to be the topic of discussion.
Yeah, that'll be that. That sounds like a good conversation.
Excellent. All right. Well, have a good week, and I hope you manage to get.
Hopefully, Charles Conwell looks sensational tonight, and that answers one of your questions.
And I think yeah, that we can reflect on that as well.
You know, he sat most of the year, and then he had a very good win on ESPN in October, beat an undefeated kid, Wendy Toussaint, and he's fighting another undefeated 54-pounder who was a great amateur. Tonight on Ring City, like I said, a Russian kid that Main Events and Igis Klimas work with. I think it'll cap off a very good year for him if he can look good tonight.
Great stuff. All right, well, we shall review next week.
Thank you, Danny. Have a good one.
Cheers, Lou, and you. Take care.
Bye-bye.